Dr. Kathleen Garinger.
We're talking about thyroid, the feel-good hormone. And we want you to get a sense for how vitally important this particular hormone is and how it kind of regulates all of your metabolism, the rate at which your body produces energy, and actually the rate at which your body burns fat as well. So let's kind of delve a little bit into this subject, because I think at this point, now that everyone can see the title on the webinar broadcast that we're sending out, and those of you who are listening on the iTunes production or SoundCloud, I want you to know that once you get an understanding about thyroid and how many people are seriously deficient and what symptoms relate to it, you're going to really appreciate that we shared this information with you. Dr. Garinger, how important is thyroid, and how good do you feel when it's optimized versus when you really have no clue and your doctor has told you, hey, your levels are normal, can't be thyroid?
I know. Well, the thyroid, again, is the feel-good hormones. When our thyroid is not at its optimum level, our energy is so tired, waking up feeling tired. You can have 10 hours of sleep and you're still tired. And the lack of focus is another signs and symptoms of thyroid insufficiency.
Well, it's so true that we kind of go through life and we make assumptions that our doctor knows best. And we assume that doctors have a clear understanding and major degree of training about hormones, which is, I'm sorry to say, farthest from the truth. There are practitioners who, how shall I say, major in the understanding about endocrinology, which is really the study of hormones. But even endocrinologists will admit that they understand how to maybe manage thyroid storm. They understand how to deal with blood sugar or insulin issues, mm-hmm. diabetics, severe and brittle diabetics, and so forth. But really, when you get down to the multiple types of hormones and interventions that the body requires, they're really not real clear about this critically substance we call hormones. What are hormones and what do they do, Dr. Garinger?
Well, hormones, they're chemical messengers that have a huge impact on our body, and they travel through our blood, and it causes changes in our organs and tissues in our body. And it's really important because they have to work in a lock and key fashion. That means they have to fit like a lock and key perfectly.
Okay, and that fit is sometimes often referred to as receptor sites. And oftentimes, as hormones go throughout the body, through the blood circulation, through various tissues, they find that place, such as, for example, testosterone has multiple receptor sites on the heart. And the heart then, when there's sufficient amount of testosterone, will function at its absolute best. In the case of thyroid, it could be a lock and key related to various organs throughout the body that stimulate or control energy metabolism, provided there's sufficient oxygen and other nutrients present, correct?
Absolutely.
So when we think about then this whole concept of hormones, I think the assumption is that your doctor understands all aspects of the multiple. In fact, right here we're showing probably close to 30 different hormones that are regulated and controlled throughout various organs of the body. However, let's not forget that the human body probably has hundreds of different hormones that we're still identifying the key role and function. And oftentimes in some of the medical lectures, we'll go into each of these hormones in great detail. In fact, it's our goal to actually launch this course for the general public and for doctors in an online course where they can access each of the functions of all of these key hormones, what role they play, and more importantly, how to regulate them. So here are the various organs. Hypothalamus, also which other organs?
The thyroid and the parathyroid.
We have the liver, the adrenals.
The kidneys and the testes.
And we do have a situation with the overall control of the pineal gland, the pituitary gland, the thymus, the stomach.
And the pancreas, ovary, and the placenta.
And the uterus.
Of course.
So when we go through, again, the overall understanding of these vitally important hormones, each of the body organs, and you can see the identifying mark showing where these particular glands are. Some people obviously will recognize the various organs that relate to the hormone production, but some of the more, if you will, obscure areas of the body, such as pineal gland, you hear the third eye, and some people talk about hypothalamus, where's that? And of course, you know, the center brainstem area. And so each of these organs then are critically important, that is glands, to produce these hormones and to help people to optimize overall function. But let's get back to our principal subject, which is thyroid. Why, I might ask, some of the people come to us and say, I always feel tired. What is that about?
Exactly. It's because your thyroid's your metabolic machine, which is your energy source. And if you see at the coffee shops, at Starbucks and stuff like that, the line starts to form around 2 or 3 p.m. Why? It's because their adrenal glands, which is married to the thyroid, starts to be all stressed out. So then it starts to crash. And what do? They grab a monster drink or caffeinated coffee to get them through the day.
It's tough because, as you said, to get through the day, some people are struggling. They don't know what to do to function. And you hit it right on the nose. They'll reach for a stimulant, literally something like caffeine, or they'll supercharge this caffeine stimulant with like coconut oil and drink it down with caffeine. When I say supercharged, you know, oils are a drug delivery for particular medications. We call it liposomal deliveries. In this case, some marketers have been putting together that combination of coconut and coffee to get people through the day and increase their metabolism and give them energy. But that's not a very elegant way to increase energy, is it? Really, the thyroid function in so much areas of regulation, and the thyroid gland, of course, is in just, say, under the chin, in the throat area, and you can palpate it as well, right?
Oh, yes. And so the thyroid gland, it actually produces a hormone that regulates our body's energy and metabolism, and it regulates our body's heart rate as well.
If say, for example, you have what's called hyperthyroidism or too high of thyroid output, the heart rate will become probably too fast, too regulated at a point where it's overworking and the body starts to overheat. If it's under or hypothyroid, the slower rate of metabolism, the energy level of the body, the rate of the heart, all of these things are influenced by basically the thyroid influences every cell, every tissue, every organ in the body. So once you say that we need to understand more about thyroid function and more importantly, what can interfere with proper thyroid function and how can we detoxify? How can we go about the necessary factors that lead to overall good health and optimum function of this vitally important organ that we often talk about, and yet very few people understand, and more importantly, very few doctors are appreciating the great importance of how thyroid protects against what?
Exactly. Our thyroid gland, it protects against fatigue, weight gain, memory loss, cognitive impairment. It helps to actually lower our cholesterol and protects us from cardiovascular diseases.
And I wanted to pause on some of these factors because people who have fatigue, of course, fatigue can be caused from more than just, say, thyroid disorders. Certainly a doctor who's well-trained, internist, even an endocrinologist or an anti-aging specialist might check for, say, for example, anemia or possibly tumor growth, such as related to depressed immune system and cancer, or weight gain could be from other causes. So let's be clear that thyroid by itself may not cause all of these symptoms, but if you are experiencing some or most of these symptoms, as we mentioned, memory loss, what is going on? And about cognitive impairment, is it Alzheimer's, is it senile dementia, or just simply someone overlooked the importance of your thyroid function, and what can we do to bring that level to optimum ranges, not just average levels, and would that improve the brain and cognitive function? I know you feel strongly of the importance of brain function. It's one of the more important organs.
Yes.
How could it be ignored, right?
Exactly. We can replace our heart, our lungs, our kidneys, but we can't replace our brain cells yet.
And here's a surprising one, and it's so common to miss, but people sometimes have elevated cholesterol. We know a lot of it is dietary related. Some of it is mm-hmm. genetic, although most would have you led to believe that it's a genetic factor and you have no control over it. We know epigenetics. We know worldwide studies around, about diet, and cultures who are virtually free of cardiovascular disease have optimum ideal cholesterol levels. But there are people who have been on a lifetime or at least a lengthy period of time on a plant-based whole foods diet, and they are not taking in extra cholesterol because cholesterol is only an animal product. Chicken, fish, turkey, eggs, and so forth. But it's not in foods as grown, plants, beans, peas, fruits, and vegetables. But there are people, if the thyroid isn't functioning properly, will have elevated cholesterol level. Isn't that true?
Yes, and we see a lot of times when we balance our patients' hormones, and that includes thyroid, testosterone, and the hormonal pathway, we notice that their cholesterol actually lowers. And It's amazing that we see the correlation between the two, and hopefully, you know, more and more studies are being released from that.
So really, let's start about a responsible way to restore optimum thyroid, and you have to think first about the core nutrient, the core, if we will, trace mineral that really supplies the building blocks for thyroid. And mm-hmm. what is that building block?
Well, iodine. Iodine is so important for our thyroid to function properly. Any kind of iodine deficiency can cause your thyroid to be deficient and impaired and can be sluggish. So when we talk about iodine, if you look at the screen on our presentation, you notice that when the doctor talks about T4, he's talking about four, means four molecules of the iodine is attached to that thyroid molecule. T3 means three molecules of iodine is attached to that thyroid molecule.
And of course, thyroid gland contains a higher concentration of iodine than any other part of the body. Mm-hmm. And yet, unfortunately, there is what's called endocrine disruptors, which we're going to get to in a moment. And there are other factors. In fact, one of the reasons why people should be taking proper amounts of iodine, not in microgram dosages, but in mm-hmm. milligram dosages, not in thousandths that are suggested in the typical multivitamin mineral, but milligram dosages, which means when we look at cultures that are exposed to radiation, Chernobyl in Russia, Fukushima in northern Japan area, even off the coast of California, there you hear of leaks on a regular basis now about these radioactive production plants. And that radioactivity, where does it go to first? If it floats through, since you can't taste iodine, or that is, you can't taste radiation, you can't see it, you can't smell it. It goes and concentrates this radiation first in the thyroid gland, which means there's a very high risk of thyroid cancer. In fact, when there are massive releases like we're now experiencing with Fukushima, there's not much press about it. It's shocking, it's terrifying, it's scary, because how long before that individual develops thyroid cancer? We know in the history of Chernobyl, and you watch that documentary, which I haven't actually seen yet. I'm going to tune it up and pull it up. I'm just catching up with a few other documentaries and books and medical journals. But the point is, we know that those who are protected from thyroid cancer or various destructive forms of tumor growth, such as in Hiroshima in Japan, when the atomic bomb went off, the only survivors in most cases were those who were eating a lot of iodine sources, such as miso soup, seaweed. We use an organic source of iodine to make sure people get these milligram dosages. And because of the competition of iodine, we're going to talk about that. But every cell in the body contains and utilizes iodine. It's that important. The body does not make iodine. So I can't make it more clear. We must supplement iodine and consume foods. If you're not accustomed to eating seaweed and miso soup and various mm-hmm. things that some of the cultures that do contain exactly. a fair amount of iodine, you're not going to get enough.
No, not enough, because everybody's like, oh, well, I eat sushi and it's just a very thin seaweed covering. You need more than just that thin covering. You need to eat sea vegetables, lots of seaweed, miso, part of miso soup. It's really important.
And Dr. Gehringer, there are other factors that affect the prior conversation about converting T4 to T3. Why would we want to convert T4 to T3? Is because T3 is the only bioactive form of thyroid that really exerts the proper benefits that we know of that are derived from getting proper thyroid function, meaning your metabolic rate, your energy, not having cold hands and feet. We'll go down this lengthy list, but you must have these following nutrients, number one, and not be deficient in them. And number two, there are certain medications that will interfere with the conversion to the proper amount of the bioactive thyroid, and there's other factors. Let's go through these factors. What nutrient deficiencies do we need to watch for, and how can we supplement our diets and reduce these nutrient deficiencies? What are they?
Well, let's summarize it a little bit. When we talk about T4, again, we're talking about the inactive form of thyroid. And when we talk about T3, we're talking about the active form of thyroid, which is the bioavailable part of thyroid. So nutrient deficiencies can cause the inability of your thyroid to convert between T4 inactive to T3 bioactive. So these nutrient deficiencies include, number one, chromium, copper, iodine, selenium, iron, zinc, vitamin A, vitamin B2, vitamin B6, and vitamin B12.
Absolutely essential. And yet, think about it. So many people might be taking, say, a multivitamin mineral, or they're eating foods that are deficient in vitamins and minerals, which the depletion of the soil has become rampant throughout the world. I'm concerned because people will take these, Centrum, they'll take these multivitamins and minerals that are supposed to supply all these nutrients at, say, 100% of the US RDA. What does that mean, RDA? And what absorption capability are these essential vitamins and minerals? And we know from studies, they're not very good from these cheap, inexpensive multivitamin mineral. And everyone wants to take a multivitamin mineral. Why? Because they want to feel secure. They think they're doing their body good. And I'm not denying that's a good first step, but really look at optimum sources. You know, Dr. Joel Wallach talks about 90 essential trace minerals and vitamins and so forth. And I tend to agree with him. You've got to get a great source. You've got to make sure you're getting the absorption. And there are certain forms of vitamins and minerals that are more absorbable than others. And some people can't absorb these, shall we say, non-absorbable forms,
particularly
when you talk about B12 and folic acid. True?
True, because so many times when they come in and they wonder why they're not feeling well and they're taking all these sorts of supplements. So getting the right kind of supplementation, getting the right type of supplementation is so important, especially where is the source coming from?
I have clients that have come to me and under a high-powered microscope, which I'm not going to show here tonight. I thought, well, I don't need to show this. But looking at the blood under a high-powered microscope on a daily basis at hundreds of people each month that come, and over the years, 40 years of looking under high blood, live blood microscopy, I can see the shape and the quality of the cells backed up by the doctors ordering CBC, complete blood cell counts, and liver and kidney function panels, and really determine, you know, are there underlying risks of anemia? Particularly vegans can be at risk for anemia, but not just vegans. It could be a person who's centering their diet around animal product, particularly if they're consuming a lot of dairy product. There could be some microbleeding in the intestines, and they could lose excess iron, and then they could be iron deficient. And does that affect thyroid? Absolutely, in terms of getting to the bioactive form. And look at all the medications that people these days are taking, and each one of them, we almost need to pause and go, we're not talking about hundreds. We're not even talking about thousands. We're talking about tens of thousands, even millions of people taking, let's go down the list of medications that can interfere with proper thyroid function.
Beta blockers, which are blood pressure medication.
And some people are being prescribed these beta blockers for heart conditions. And what, the number one killer in the country and probably in the Western world is related to hypertension and also heart disease and stroke. So we're talking about millions of people that might have developed a thyroid deficiency due to the prescription and the doctor not being aware that they better look at thyroid function. What about the number of women and those prescribe birth control pills for acne. And we get a big percentage of the audience because we work with people having written the book, Acne Be Gone for Good. So what's going on with these birth control pills, and what is the magnitude of the issue regarding thyroid?
Well, with birth control pills, we know that it's synthetic hormones that are suppressing your hormones from conceiving. So what happens is that, again, it binds with the receptor cells of your thyroid. So your thyroid's not able to function at its optimum levels. And again, Dr. Nick and I are here not saying, oh, get off of your blood pressure pills, get off of your birth control pills or any of your pills. What we're saying that if you are placed on these medication, make sure you support what it's going to cause the deficiency to minimize the side effects as much as possible while you go and address the root cause of your blood pressure.
And that's true. And consider this, that there are, as I mentioned, an alarming number of young girls being prescribed birth control pills off-label, not even for the purpose of birth control, but to control the acne in their skin, because the accidental discovery that birth control pills tend to increase what's a binding globulin called sex hormone binding globulin, which that tends to calm down the active androgens that get into the skin and can cause acne. But there's a more elegant way. There's ways to control. There's four steps we teach in another one of our courses, Acne Be Gone for Good, in the book and the Acne Bootcamp. And we go into the steps. So a number of women are being able to come off these harmful, and I'll say harmful, birth control pills, because the side effects associated can be horrendous, not let alone the interference with thyroid. And that's your metabolism, your energy, may be the other reason why women on birth control pills tend to gain weight.
Yes. Uh-huh.